In today's video, I will try to answer some of the more tough questions to answer in landscape photography. I asked on Instagram a few weeks ago, ask me anything, and I pulled out some of the more interesting questions. So here are my answers. And the first question is, how big of a percentage of landscape photographers are in it just to get positive attention on the social medias? And in all honesty, I don't think it's a whole lot. Of course, some people are in it to get some kind of attention, but we all are. We all want to be recognized for the work we do. Like, it's such an important part of being human being, part of our psychology, that we want to get acknowledged. But if it's the only reason why you do it, then I do believe that you won't last long in landscape photography, because it's hard to be a landscape photographer. And yeah, if you are only here to get attention on social media, it's just very empty, right? It's not the main reason why we do it. We do it to be creative. We do it for environmental reasons. We do it for our own sakes, our own satisfaction, more so than getting the satisfaction of social media. So yeah, if that's the reason you're in it, fair enough. But I don't think a whole lot of people at least last long in landscape photography if that's the reason they're in it. So next question, what lens would I choose if I could only choose one lens? Well, gun to my head, and I can only choose one lens. Since I am using the Sony system, I would go with the Tamron 28-200mm. These days, I see myself shoot less and less ultra wide angle, and it just covers such a big focal length range. So 28-200 covers almost everything I need for landscape photography. And I don't really need those really extreme apertures, even though it does go all the way down to f2.8. It's not super sharp at f2.8, and I wouldn't really use it. So for clean landscape photography, here we're not talking astrophotography, night photography and those things, but just landscape photography, I would definitely, look at my hair, go with the 28-200, simply just because it covers such a huge focal length range. The next question is, what is my biggest struggle as a landscape photographer? Right now, it's not looking like a boy band person from the 90s with this hair. Oh my God. All right, so the biggest struggle for me as a landscape photographer, I have actually pondered for a long time about this, and I do think it's about longevity, making photos that I myself are satisfied with for a long time. That is my big struggle. Like taking a photo and then just be like, this is really good, even like years after. So obviously as landscape photographers, we keep growing, we keep learning, we get experiences, and over time, we kind of figure out what it is we like to photograph. And that is where we start to like diverge off of like the, for the most people, set path of HDR trends, Instagram trends, wide angle lens trends, and so forth. Shooting in the golden hour, like breaking all of those things that we probably all do. And over time, you kind of figure out what it is you like to photograph yourself. And then you can start to like take photos, analyze your old portfolio, figure out what it is that works for you over time. But the thing is that it takes a lot of time to figure that out, because you just need to take a whole lot of photos to analyze what works for you and what doesn't work for you, and then you need time. And then when you have figured it out over time, your taste has probably changed. So in that way, what worked for you 2 years ago may not work anymore. So in that way, it's a constant battle, I think, to keep making photos that are interesting in the long term for yourself. Obviously, some of your photos, which will be popular on social media here and now, is probably also popular in a couple of years, or 4 or 10 years. But for yourself, that for me is the biggest struggle, I think, in my landscape photography. So next question is, how do you fix composition fails in post-processing? And the thing about composition is that's the one thing you need to get right in camera. You can't really change the composition so much. You can of course crop the photo afterwards just to maybe change the balance a little bit of the photo. But after that, you really have to go in and start highly manipulate the photo. And obviously, depending on what kind of photographer you are, some people don't mind heavy manipulated photos, whereas others like really do not like it. But that's up to yourself to decide. But obviously, you can use all sorts of different methods, like focus stack blending, or you can go in and use the liquify tool and push things around, skew things a little bit in Photoshop. There's a whole lot of different things you can do, but when it does come to composition, it is just the one thing you need to get right in camera. And speaking of which, if you aren't out about composition in landscape photography, be sure to get my eBooks, 2 eBooks on composition landscape photography. I cover almost everything you need to know to get started or to advance your photography, your compositions in landscape photography. They have got plenty of 5-star reviews, so people are really, really happy about them. So if you aren't out, check out the light versions also. Also links down in the description for those. So next question is the one thing that I personally always look for in a photograph, whether I'm taking it or I'm looking at it. And a lot of photographers might say story. And yeah, but the problem is landscape photography, storytelling is rather hard. It's some fairly, one would maybe even say weak stories that we tell. It's not really a Ken Follett novel, right? But the one thing I'm looking for is that whatever it is the photographer is taking a photo of, that it makes sense, that there is a subject, that there is at the very least a focal point, something that I can look at, something that I can identify that the photographer wanted me to see. And it doesn't have to be an object like a tree or a lighthouse or a castle or a mountain or something like that, a specific subject slash object. It can also just be like patterns in the sand, in the snow, how waves act in the photo. The point is that it should just make sense. And I, as the viewer, shouldn't be in doubt about what it is the photographer is taking a photo of. So a little bit of intention behind the photo is very important for me when I look at it. So the next question is, how do I keep being motivated? And the irony is that I'm not always motivated for landscape photography. There are definitely periods where I'm just like, oh, do I have to get out? But I do find that most of the times when I am demotivated, it's because there's a lot of external factors that keeps me from actually going out, that takes away my freedom to be spontaneous. I don't know, I just have, I guess, this inner creativity, and I've always had it. Like when I was a child, I really liked drawing, and I've done videography way longer than I've done photography. And yeah, now it's photography. I like being out, I like being here, like beautiful day. It's not like the best for landscape photography right now, but nevertheless, it's just the enjoyment of creating. Going back to the very first question of this video, whether it's how many people are there just because they get attention on social media, there's no secret from my side that it also motivates me that I get positive feedback from other people. As I said, it is a basic thing of our psychology. That doesn't mean that I can't take photos that I know won't be popular on social media, but I can analyze myself why it's a great photo, and in that way I'm like, okay, this is a really great photo, even though a lot of people don't like it as much as some of my other photos. So when it comes to motivation, I guess it's just a question about getting out. Often when I get out, I get even more motivated. When I don't want to get out and I actually do pull myself together and get out, I'm just in it. I'm just in the elements. Wind, rain, sunset, sunrises, fog, like almost anything goes. So maybe, I don't know, just get out. So the next question is, what is my favorite time of day and year to photograph? And that one is easy for me. Late summer, before the autumn colors kick in. I know that a lot of landscape photographers really, really love autumn photography. Late summer for me, I still like the dark green lush trees. And there's also a bigger chance of actually getting fog during sunrise. It's a little bit more wet, the climate. So definitely late summer, August, September, maybe even October, but there the trees start to change into the fall colors, at least in Denmark. So yeah, that's definitely my favorite time of day. But of course, I don't stray away from any kind of storms, heavy winds, dramatic clouds, all the dramatic weather in general. I really enjoy photographing in that too. So next question, will I ever do a vlog about film photography, I guess analog photography, landscape photography? No. Well, okay, never say never, but most likely no. Film photography is just not for me. I love also the post-processing part, and the other thing, it just, I don't know, it just doesn't speak to me to spend so much effort on those technical stuff, dare I say. I'll probably piss off a lot of analog photographers saying that, but no thank you, it's not for me. In regard to post-processing, there was also a question about what's my most used tool for post-processing. Well, Camera Raw, Adobe Camera Raw, bringing down highlights, bringing up shadows, adding contrast, and then luminosity masking. I use it so much to edit my photos. And if you want to learn how I do that, edit my photos, be sure to enroll in my huge Photoshop for Landscape Photographers post-processing course. I teach everything I know about post-processing, and there is a discount code down in the description where you can save some dollars. I've really designed it in a very progressive way, so it should be easy for beginners to start and advanced users to learn even more. And if you're only a Lightroom user, hopefully I've designed it also so it's very, very easy for you to jump into Photoshop and really, really improve on your editing skills. So check out links down in the description to enroll in the huge Photoshop course. So the last question, is there any spots in Denmark that you shouldn't miss out on? Yeah, this one here. If you come to do iconic landscape photography in Denmark, I would say that Rubjerg Knude Lighthouse is probably the one place not to miss. It's so amazing up here. But the video that I'm going to shoot up here is going to be for next week. I hope you enjoyed this video. If so, let me hear some thoughts also down in the comments. What are your biggest struggle in landscape photography? I'm quite curious about that. But yeah, thanks so much for watching. As always, I would highly appreciate a like.